I think Trump's done an extraordinary job. I mean, if you look at what we laid out, in the campaign, which was a handful of things. Number one, stop mass illegal immigration, limit legal immigration to get our sovereignty and jobs back. Number two, start to bring jobs back from Mexico and China. And number three, get out of these pointless foreign wars. Across the board, the economy's at 3%, unemployment, black unemployment, all-time low, Hispanic unemployment, 17-year low. Wages for the working class are starting to rise initially. And I think the most importantly, his engagement. Everybody was afraid that America was going to be isolationist, that America first meant some sort of, return to what Lindbergh wanted in the 30s, and it's been the exact opposite. I mean, he promised on his inauguration address, and I think the quote was, we will form new alliances and rejuvenate old ones, and with the civilized world, eradicate radical Islamic terrorism from the face of the earth, starting with ISIS. It hasn't been perfect, but I think directionally he's accomplished a lot, and I think he's very well positioned for this fall.
You talk about directionally. If you look from the outside, you see this high staff turnover, you see the endless leaks, you see the divisions, you see the jobs unfilled at the State Department, you see, to a certain extent, chaos. Is it healthy for America to be governed like that?
I think I refer back to the signal and the noise. Okay? Donald Trump's a disruptor. He's an entrepreneur. The campaign ran like this. He has a certain house style that at 71 years old, you're not going to change. You have about five or six people directly reporting to him. He's much more comfortable. He has his sea legs now, and I think you're starting to see much more action-oriented coming out of the White House.
Are you one of those? Are you back
well, no,
in
no,
the
he's,
circle
well,
now?
No. Look, he's got the outside guys of Corey, Bossie. I am there. I've got a C4 that I've set up to kind of do
you
messaging.
See?
I take everything through attorneys because I'm in the middle of the Mueller. Well, I'm in the middle of the Mueller investigation, right? The very first thing when Mueller brings you in there, one of the very first things he wants to know is your conversations with the president. I think that very shortly that either Rosenstein is going to take the direct order of the president of the United States, or I think Rosenstein will be fired.
Do you think Mueller should be fired?
I do not think Mueller should be fired. Bob Mueller's an honorable guy. He's a combat Marine. He's somebody that served his country. I don't agree with everything that's been going on the special counsel, but I think he's run it. I hope at some time he does issue the report. Rudy Giuliani says it's going to be sometime.
Do you think Donald Trump should testify?
I do not think that the president should testify. I just don't. I don't think it rises to that level. I think he can answer those questions in writing. I do think he ought to answer the questions.
Why wouldn't you let him then? Because when the president assumes a position of being above the law, it doesn't
look... By the way, he's not above the law. I said he should answer the questions in writing. President Trump, let's step back for a second. In the Reagan, the Clinton, and the Bush administration all had situations with this, right? Even in Nixon, all had situations in this where you had a special counsel or a special prosecutor, okay? Trump, unlike any of the others, waived executive privilege immediately and shipped over 1.1 million documents and then made everybody in the White House go up and answer every question on Capitol Hill. The president should definitely cooperate with the special counsel, but I don't think he has to go sit as a witness. And I would tell Rudy that the president shouldn't, unless it's absolutely necessary. The president should answer those questions in writing.
You are seen as the architect of the 2016 election, the man who, if you like, closed the deal, delivered Trump to power.
No,
is that fair?
No, that's totally not fair. You got to remember, Trump is unique in American political history. He's his own closer. And one of the things that came in with 88 days to go, now he was down, 12 or 16 points, depending on how you look at it, double digits in battleground states. But all he needed to do was kind of refocus the message. Compare and contrast Hillary Clinton. What was not being done was hold Hillary Clinton up as the guardian of a corrupt and incompetent establishment. And Donald Trump would be the tribune in this kind of populist nationalist ride. And so the Make America Great Again, that had real traction. And all Trump had to do was give people permission to vote for him, particularly about being commander-in-chief.
So what was your role then?
Well, I came in as CEO and I helped, recalibrate. Look, they had kind of lost their message. He had been criticizing the Gold Star parents and the Mexican judges, and people had just kind of lost focus. I stepped in and just kind of got the thing refocused. And by the way, all you have to do is deliver Trump on a stage, right, in front of a crowd and use social media to kind of drive people around it. Donald Trump closed that deal.
You told Trump that he could win after the Access Hollywood tape emerged, in which he
100%
described grabbing women by the pussy. What made you so sure that voters wouldn't reject a president who admitted to that?
On August 13th, when I stepped in and took the job as CEO, he was 16 points down, double digits down. I said to 100% metaphysical certitude, you will win this. If you focus on the handful of messages about the American working man and woman in our country, and on Billy Bush weekend, where people were losing their heads and running around, and you know, you're gonna have Mike Pence and Condi Rice run as a ticket, and Trump's gotta jump out of the race, and Paul Ryan says, I take back my my support of Donald Trump, and everybody's bailing out. I said, look, as we went around this thing, I said, you still have 100% certitude you're gonna win. And he got upset. He says, don't give me 100%, tell me what the real number is. I said, it's 100%. I said, they don't care. What they're fighting for is their country.
Trump had talked about grabbing women by the pussy. You have now said that the Time's Up movement is the most important movement. It's going to overdo 10,000 years in history.
It's the competing movement to the populist nationalist movement. Yes, it's very powerful.
Right.
It's trying to upend 5,000 years or 10,000 years of the patriarchy. Yes.
So that's going to make things harder.
It's Handmaid's Tale as a political movement.
Right. So isn't that going to make things difficult for Trump?
I think in the irony, I think that I tell people that it was divine providence that allowed our band of pirates to win the presidency with Donald Trump on Election Day. It took kind of divine intervention. But in the great irony, you know, President Trump, for some reason, triggers this Time's Up movement. And so that's one of the reasons I think they're so impassioned.
So why did you back Roy Moore then for the Senate race in Alabama last December. He was accused of sexual misconduct against underage girls.
Hang on. I don't believe the charges against Roy Moore. I've looked at the charges. I don't believe the charges. I just don't believe it.
You don't sit here thinking, I backed the wrong horse.
No,
that
absolutely
was a
not.
Bad judgment.
Absolutely not. No. I think there's a big lesson. There's certainly a lesson for the evangelical right that the establishment Republicans of Mitch McConnell would rather have a Democrat in that seat than to have someone that's a member of the evangelical right. No, I do not believe the charges against Roy Moore.
You were the White House chief strategist, and one of the first things you put in place was the travel ban from 7 majority Muslim countries. On the campaign trail, many will remember that Trump had called for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the country. So the ban was anti-Muslim, wasn't it?
No, it wasn't. We took that. Remember, this was about extreme vetting. This was about vetting so that people, we couldn't have the problems that occurred in Europe, you know, or we had in the United States. This was all about extreme vetting. What we did was we took the list basically from the Obama administration.
A total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the country. That was his line on the campaign.
It was a line that before I got there. It wasn't after August 13th, and I don't ever remember him using that line about no Muslims. This, by the way, the ban included countries like Iraq, and after we reviewed it in Iraq and other people came forward with better vetting techniques, they were taken off the list. And so this was, by the way, this was about the President of the United States, the Commander-in-Chief, which I think the Supreme Court's going to support, having the ability to make sure that he can keep the country safe and extreme vetting.
We're having problems with Muslims. We're having problems with Muslims coming into the country. Now,
we did have problems because radical Islamic terror came over here.
But the
radical Islamic terrorism were Muslims, right? I don't think he made a case that all Muslims should be banned. We didn't. Donald Trump has gone out of his way to embrace Muslim countries. Look at what's just happened with the JCPOA. The central tenet, Pompeo gave the 12 points yesterday. The bulk of those points are about interconnecting Iranian behavior with its expeditionary exporting of Hezbollah terrorism against Sunni Arab countries, Muslim countries. So how can anybody sit there? How can anybody sit there and say Donald Trump has not been someone that's embraced the nations that are tied to Islam?
You're saying he pulled out of the Iran deal because he loved Muslims.
I'm saying he pulled out of the Iran deal because he thought that both Iran's efforts to get a nuclear weapon and, most importantly, that its behavior with Hezbollah was a problem with the nations in the Middle East and the nations in the Gulf and Israel. Yes, he absolutely did that. It was not looked to mock Muslims. And I think no president that I've seen in living memory has done what President Donald Trump has done and gotten no credit for working with the Muslim nations of the world for their security and peace.
I want to get to Steve Bannon, the ideologue. You told The Hollywood Reporter, darkness is good. Dick Cheney, Darth Vader, Satan, that's power. It only helps us when they get it wrong. Meaning?
Well, I was telling that, you know, that people are, particularly the Democratic left and the opposition party media, that if you have a, you know, because I was very unknown at the time being on the campaign, that if you have this, and they all say, oh, you're Darth Vader, you know, you're Satan. And I just said, hey, you know, it's not so bad having that reputation. I'm not there to make friends. I'm not there to have the media be my buddy. I'm not there to impress Democrats. I'm there to do a job. And so I said, hey, if that's what the, cause the guy was saying, they think you're Dick Cheney, they think you're Darth Vader, they think you're Satan. And I said, you know, darkness is good because darkness puts out something of being a honey badger, that you don't care and you're just gonna get the job done. So I'm not worried about my image. I'm not worried about if I'm looked at as a nice guy or somebody that you're gonna have a beer with. I could care less. I'm there. You know, I served in the military. I come from kind of a blue-collar, democratic family. I'm there because I believe in this populist movement. I believe in this nationalist movement. I've been working on it since really the financial crisis of 2008.
In our viewers' minds, you are the man who's driven a nationalistic, divisive, dangerous, arguably racist agenda right into the mainstream. You've emboldened white supremacists. You've allowed, as one person put it to me, the Ku Klux Klan.
This is the opposition party. This is why the media has no credibility. This is why the great BBC and the Financial Times of London and the Economist and the New York Times and the Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal, all the mainstream media, which are basically the communications department for the global elites. Okay,
this is why
you sit there in nonsense. Economic nationalism, and I've said this in every speech I've ever given, and you look at the policies of Donald Trump and it backs it up 100%. Economic nationalism doesn't care about your race, doesn't care about your gender, doesn't care about your ethnicity, doesn't care about your religion. What it cares about, doesn't care about your sexual preference. The only thing it cares about is, are you a citizen of the United States of America? And look at Donald Trump's policies, okay? Donald Trump's policies, by limiting massive illegal immigration is a scam of the globalists, supported by the BBC and the Wall Street Journal and the Financial Times. Hang on. Because it's there to suppress the wages of the black and Hispanic working class by giving unlimited competition on labor. Donald Trump has gone out of his way to restrict, even without having built the wall, to restrict illegal alien labor, and you're starting to see wages rise. You're seeing wages in agriculture and construction start to rise. You have the lowest black unemployment in history, the lowest Hispanic unemployment in 20 years. Those things didn't just happen. They're the active agency of Donald Trump and these policies. These policies are the, not just least racist, the racist policies before are to have unfair competition.
Help me understand economic nationalism, because it sounds like a grandiose phrase which has no basis in economics. It is a blame the foreigner strategy at heart, isn't it?
No. Look at this for a second. First off, England's a great example because this radical idea of free trade, the British didn't do it when they built their empire. Right now, there's not a world of free trade. The United States is open for trade, but we're against a mercantilist power in China. The United States is a tributary state to China. We're Jamestown to their Great Britain. We send them, you know, natural gas and soybeans and hogs and beef and Boeing jets and Apple products. Oh, excuse me, we don't send Boeing jets and Apple products anymore because they do those in joint ventures in China. We send virtually no high value added manufacturing. That can't continue. This is one thing the globalist elite and their mouthpieces in the Financial Times make it seem like it's the second law of thermodynamics that these jobs happen to be shifted to China. That's total BS.
So
it is not. Those jobs can come back if you enforce reasonable trade by. They're a mercantilist power. They don't play by any of the rules. And yet the elites in this country cheered them on. Oh, if China just gets wealthy, if China develops a middle class, they're going to be a liberal democracy. Well, hey, guess what? That's wrong. This is more than just economics. Okay, when we talk about tariffs, it's just not about some sort of jobs. It's just not about prices of products. It's about dignity. It's about self-worth. It's about people who feel that they mean something in their community.
You make such a forceful argument. If it is all about trade, why do you go around the world befriending fascists? Why do you allow David Duke of the Ku Klux Klan to say that you've been really helpful?
Will you stop? This is the mainstream media. These guys don't exist unless you make them a big deal. They're totally irrelevant as far as, first off, they're all cranks. Donald Trump has said that, I have said that, they're all cranks. And it's a very, you know, Spencer and Duke, these guys are cranks. The only reason they exist is because MSNBC and BBC's down there with the camera giving them a platform. If you cut them off, nobody would ever hear from them.
Look at the company you keep in Europe here. You told a rally of Le Pen supporters, when they call you a racist, wear it as a badge.
Okay, but hang on, don't just go through. What was the buildup? I said Donald Trump has the lowest black unemployment in history. Donald Trump has the lowest Hispanic unemployment in 25 years. If you look at the policies of Donald Trump, okay? Anybody. Martin Luther King would be proud of him, of what he's done to the, for the black and Hispanic community for jobs. So I said, if what they're going to do...
You think Martin Luther King will be proud of Donald Trump as president?
His economic policies to black... By the way, it's the lowest unemployment in recorded history. You don't think Martin Luther King wouldn't be proud? Look at the unemployment we had in the black community 5 years ago. You don't think Martin Luther King would sit there and go, yes, you're putting young black men and women to work, the lowest unemployment we've had in history, and wages are starting to rise among the working class, and you finally stop the illegal alien labor force that's coming in and competing with them every day and destroying the schools and destroying the health care? Absolutely. Do you think getting out of the city, look, the capitalists and globalists, they want unlimited labor, right? Because that's why they can pay 10 bucks an hour and not pay for the schools and not pay for the health care. So when I was sitting there with Le Pen, I said, when you have that record and they call you a racist, it means they can't debate the facts. Wear that with pride, and I wear it with pride. When they call me a racist, I go, you know why you're doing that? Because you don't want to talk about economic nationalism. You don't want to talk about that it has nothing to do with race or gender or ethnicity or religion. You don't want to talk about what the facts are. You want to smear somebody, and here's the beauty of it. It's a loser. Okay, identity politics is what Hillary Clinton ran behind. The smart people in the Democratic Party understand that. They understand they have to have a counter narrative to Trump's economic policies. And you're seeing the smartest people in the Democratic Party sit there and go, hey, we can't keep doing this identity politics thing because it's not working.
Let me ask you to be clear then. Sure. The message on the Statue of Liberty is now past its sell-by date.
That's not true. That's not true.
We don't want your poor. Don't bring us your poor anymore.
That's not true. Listen, we let in more people than any nation on earth. What we have to do is to focus on American citizens, okay? What we have to do is make sure that it's immigration that's correct for the country. 50% of the families in this country, 50%, can't put $400 together in cash in case of emergency. That's a disgrace.
Before we leave this completely, and I know you don't mind because you raised Martin Luther King, there is one specific set of events. When you were in power, the Charlottesville protests, Richard Spencer, a prominent white supremacist, was a speaker. He's somebody who proposes, what is it, peaceful ethnic cleansing in Europe. After the death of that female protester, President Trump criticized violence on many sides.
Well, President Trump was saying, "This, I'm from the South, okay, I come from Virginia. That was a protest about the statues of Confederate generals." And what President Trump is saying, because he said, where does it end? Does it end in Mount Vernon? Does it end in the Washington Monument? Does it end in the founders that were slaveholders? Does it end in people like Lincoln and other people that that might have not had the sensibilities about African Americans we have today? His point was, on that original protest, there were good people on both sides. That's a protest of some people saying, hey, these statues are about Southern culture and they have to stay. And other people
saying,
he was talking about the protest, but he was talking about that protest. Okay? And he said, they're good people on both sides, right? Because there are people that want the statues to come down immediately or to be put up. The violent protesters, and this deals with the Richard Spencers and that crowd of neo-Nazis and neo-Confederates and KKK that have no place in political society, okay? And the Charlottesville police should have never, they were coming there looking for a fight, they never should have given them a permit, and that's because local authorities let these guys go. These guys are thugs and looking for trouble. But however, the Antifa guys are just as bad. They're there, they come fully loaded, they're looking for a fight.
That was a dumb thing to say, wasn't it? I mean, in the heat of it, it was a dumb thing to say.
I don't agree with that at all. I think that he was saying, we look at context, and I think he had the most brilliant thing he said. His point was, where does it end? You're going to take down Mount Vernon? You're going to take down the Washington Monument? You know, Washington was a slaveholder.
You left the White House shortly after that episode. Was it because you fell out with the...
No, it's one year. It's 1 year. I told Maggie Haberman very early on. In fact, I went to John Kelly at the 1st of August and said, I'm out of here on the 14th. I came to work on the campaign on the 14th of August, and I left on the 14th.
You got fired.
Oh, no, absolutely not. In fact, ask John Kelly, John Dowd. I went to those guys on the 1st of August, and they went to the president and said, hey, when Reince left, John Kelly's coming in, I'm going to take off.
You called Ivanka dumb as a brick, and you called Ivanka dumb as a brick. Is that right?
I can neither confirm nor deny. I haven't read Fire and Fury, but...
Don Jr., treasonous behavior.
But I did correct that later and said that was for Manafort. Don Jr. is a real patriot. He's a good guy.
It's hard to come back. It was a dumb. If you've fallen out with the Trump family members, it's hard for you to come back.
I don't think so. I think the president is a very practical guy.
Is he an imperfect vessel for revolution?
You know, Donald Trump is a unique combination of characters. He's an entrepreneur. I think people forget that he didn't come from corporate America. He didn't come from big corporations. He's a street fighter. If we hadn't had Donald Trump, We have not won in 2016. Let's go to the midterms.
Right.
The Democratic Party, they've been wishing for this since 2:30 in the morning on the 9th of November 2016. What they wanted is a do-over. They've bitched and moaned and whined about everything. It's Russia's fault. It's that it wasn't the popular vote. They've had every excuse in the world. So they finally got what they want. They're going to have a do-over. This November 6th, it's going to be an up or down vote on the impeachment of Trump. I mean, he talked about that.
You think he's going to win, or you think he can hold on to both chambers?
I think we'll hold on to both chambers. I didn't think at first the way things were going with the power of the Time's Up movement and the energy in the Time's Up movement. I thought that people were unfocused. They're trying to run on tax cuts. You can't. This has got to be very simple. To bring the base out, to bring the deplorables out, you're going to have a proposition. It's a national election. Donald Trump is on the ballot in every congressional district. You're not voting for a congressman versus another congressman. You're voting for Donald Trump versus Nancy Pelosi. Because the first thing she's going to do is impeach you. And so I think if you make it up or down vote, and then everything goes up underneath that, all the great economic policies he's done, the national security, the deals that he's trying to get done with Korea, what he's doing in the Persian Gulf, what he's doing with Iran, destroying ISIS, it all rolls up into one simple question. Do you want him impeached or not? And the Democrats, by the way, the smart Democrats, Rahm Emanuel and guys like Joe Scarborough and even Nancy Pelosi say, oh, no. We can't talk about impeachment. We can't talk about impeachment because they've done the polling. They understand if we make this about impeachment on November 6th in an up or down vote, the deplorables will turn out. And I got to tell people, I think the intensity of this campaign as it picks up over the summer we're going to have a turnout like a presidential election of like 2008. It's going to be massive. It's going to blow out numbers for any midterm. His second presidential run is this year. His second presidential run is this year because it's going to prove whether he's got a presidency or not, because the Democrats are full-throated. They want to do one thing. He's triggered them. They don't think that he's a legitimate president.
Europe. As well as the National Front, you've supported Fidesz in Hungary, Viktor Orban's party, and the recent success of Matteo Salvini, La Liga in Italy. Is that what you think the future is, the end of liberal democracies in Europe?
Well, why do you say liberal democracies? The last time I looked, they were all voted into office. They're populist. This is another thing. You know, the BBC and the Financial Times and the Economist are all in meltdown. Okay, guess what? The globalization project that you promoted was wrong. Okay, it didn't work. It's time to embrace that. And when people in Hungary or in the Czech Republic or in Italy want to take their country back and want to get their sovereignty back and want to get their citizens back, it's not the end of the world. You guys all sit there, it's the end of the liberal democracy, it's the rise of fascism. Look at what happened in Italy. In Italy, you had a right-wing populist party and a left-wing populist party. You had Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders.
And when you
and guess what? Hang on. And it came together. Kind of what I said, I just kind of threw it out there after I said, if you could put your basic economic differences aside and join up, you would actually have something that had over 60% of the vote and you'd have real power. And you could show what populism could do. What I think that Italy shows that we're beyond the left-right, you know, paradigm that we've had. We're in a new age.
So does it matter to you when Viktor Orban is talking about defending Christian Europe or when he's saying he doesn't want a colorful country? You know what that means.
I think Viktor Orban is a patriot and of Hungary, and I think the people of Hungary have to decide that. I think
What does patriot mean? Does it mean somebody who doesn't want people of other colors?
When Viktor Orban says something about protecting the Judeo-Christian West, okay, I don't think that's the end of the world. And by the way, Donald Trump and the deplorables, the people that Hillary Clinton say are irredeemable, they believe that Western Christendom and the Judeo-Christian West and the values that we have, okay, even for secular people, are worth defending. And I think that's what this movement's about. The United States is not going to be isolationist. We want to be allies. What you can't be is a protectorate. It's time that the Europeans and NATO stepped up and were a partner to the United States to try to defend the West.
Last question. You talk about allies. You were there when Theresa May met Donald Trump at the White House. What did he think of her? Because there is all this admiration for Brexit, yet Emmanuel Macron comes in and he's the new best friend and he's going to choose the trade deal with the EU. We know that.
Well, I think that, look, Macron and the president have a special relationship. You got to remember, Macron was a Rothschild's banker, so he knows how to focus on a client. I mean, he's done a very good job of building a personal relationship with President Trump. President Trump likes him a lot. And by the way, they had a great time in the United States, and Macron goes to Congress and basically dumps all over the populist nationalist movement. They have a relationship. I think people have to get comfortable. Well, I think Theresa May, it's not that he doesn't have a relationship. He very much loves the United Kingdom. He's built a golf course in Scotland. His family's heritage is from Scotland. He has a very deep feeling for the British people. Nigel Farage is quite close to him. And so
we're going to get that trade deal post-Brexit?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I don't think there's any doubt. A trade deal with the United Kingdom and the United States, as we told when I was there, when the guys came in, we said as soon as you're eligible to negotiate it, which is not yet, you'll get a trade deal very quickly. So I don't think there's any doubt that the United Kingdom will get a trade deal and get a trade deal that's a fair trade deal between two partners.
Would Steve Bannon ever stand for office?
No. I'm not a politician. I'm a street fighter.
Steve Bannon, thank you.
Thank you for having me.